and ElixirConf. So we rebranded, so we're taking over. So just to get this out of the way, this is like exciting to some people and then like terrifying for others. We don't want to work communities. So the idea with bringing Phoenix into branding is Phoenix is becoming a big entry point into the Elixir community. So we don't want to work communities and have a separate Phoenix conference. So the idea is we can have a multi-track conference and kind of have to go with the best of both worlds, because ultimately Phoenix is not some extra special thing, it's just one part of your Elixir application. So it's super exciting to me to have Phoenix up on stage with the Elixir, but ultimately it's about communities growing together rather than apart. Before I start talking about Phoenix, I'm going to talk about thinking new people. Docker, obviously, we heard from, but this is a huge deal for me, because as Brian said, I've worked almost entirely full-time on Phoenix for the last 10 months, which is kind of what I needed personally. So my primary role there is to work on open source. I do have client engagements, but it's kind of what I needed to not play now, because I was kind of on a burnout trajectory, working full-time and trying to do open source really full-time meetings. So I have OU, thank you, Dr. Arden. Kind of we all do, because they're investing in the community, they're investing in Phoenix, and for me personally, it's what I needed to kind of have this, land in this happy place. So thank you, and if you want to reach out to us, check out blackheart.com. I also want to thank Jim Priest, where Jim's at here. Jim, raise your hand. Where are you? Right here in the back. Jim is the unsung hero of this community. He organized this conference. We organized the very first ElixirConf, World Server 1.0. People probably thought he was crazy, but really, we're all here today because of Jim. And there's a ton of work that goes into all this. So if you see Jim, give him a huge thank you. Let's give him a round of applause.
Incredibly fast-paced trajectory, and so
so exciting to kind of be a part of it from the beginning and have everyone here today. So just by show of hands, who here has Phoenix Construction? Okay, keep your hands up, I want to take a picture of this. That's actually, I expected it to be by view, but that's amazing, so awesome. I mean, so for me, like, I like programming because I get to build things, and kind of doing open source is kind of like this meta way for me to not have to build things, but other people can build things using something that I did. So for me, that's like the most exciting part, seeing what people create based on the work that I've done. So that's amazing. Thank you. And also, like, this is a meaningless number, but we reached 1 million downloads on X. We don't have 1 million users of Phoenix, but next steps that I get have been run a million times, you know, by developers, CI servers. So for me, psychologically, this was a kind of really cool milestone, and I'm looking forward to seeing kind of, you know, how this continues to grow. And the last year, the main focus for me in Phoenix was Phoenix Presence, and we're literally, like, people are losing their minds over it. It's cool. But it's really neat for me because Phoenix Presence, for those of you that don't know, basically a way to show who's online in your application. And it's a hard problem to solve correctly. It talked to us a lot last year, but we were able to apply some really cutting-edge computer science research to solve a simple problem as far as Phoenix users are concerned. And people hear about how it works internally, and they're literally like losing their minds. But for me, that's the most exciting thing because it's showing that they have this amazing platform that we can accomplish really innovative solutions. And I think it's gonna attract people to the platform, the way that we're applying, you know, not only cutting-edge research, that for me is intellectually fulfilling programming, is we're solving these problems day to day. So it's not only this great research that we're applying, it's how can we apply that research to day to day problems that everyone has. And I want to, like, hit this one right here, where this has come up a lot, especially since this Elixir and ElixirConf. People are saying, since a lot of users are coming into the Elixir community through Phoenix, you know, is Elixir only good for web? This question comes up a lot with, like, the undertone of because Phoenix. And I just want to say, no, absolutely not. But this really irritates me because when I started Phoenix, I wanted to kind of redefine what a web application is. So we have amazing things in the community that are happening, like the Nurse Project, which I think could be much bigger than Phoenix. But this question and this mindset really irritates me because Phoenix is already being used outside of what you would even consider the web. So we have people putting Phoenix on like little Raspberry Pis and doing cool things with embedded devices like that are running Phoenix. So it's like this mindset that it's literally only good for web because Phoenix is just really irritating because people are doing crazy things outside the web. Like Justin Sneck, one of the core committers on the Nurse Project, made this labeling thing that, like, yeah, iOS, native iOS app speaking the Phoenix channels that's running on this little Pi here, using 16 megabytes of memory. And he had, like, gyroscope information at 50 hertz, so 50 messages a second about the access information of his iPhone as he tilted, were controlling gyros over the Phoenix channel running on this Pi. So for me, people are doing crazy things with Phoenix outside the context of the web, and that's what excites me the most. So I think, you know, Elixir is going to eat the world in every direction. We have people doing things on embedded devices. We have people, you know, writing distributed databases. We have everything on the low end that we can eat the world, and then we have everything on the high end to eat the world. So you can run it on a whole Pi using 16 megs of memory, or you can run it on a 44 server using 85 gigs of memory. And for me, like, this is what's incredible. Like, I have no experience with any other technology that is eating, that can eat the world at the low and high end. And for me, I think we're going to take over the land. So I'm excited about that. So that's what happened last year. I was at Phoenix Presence. It was a typical honor, I thought, as does everything in software. But let's look forward with Phoenix 1.3. So Phoenix 1.3, we have some unfortunate casualties. So the Google level web order is dying, as is the word model or any reference to a model in the code base. So we have to have a little bit of course correction, I think, but let's talk about why. So prior to Phoenix 1.3, we had And we had a three-level web folder, which Jose and I thought was a great idea. And like, separate your, like the initial idea was, let's separate the web part of your application from the Elixir part of your application. So like, let's send this good message that, you know, Phoenix isn't special. And what happened was people saw this three-level web folder and it became like, oh, what is that? Phoenix is special and loaded. It's a Phoenix app, it's not an Elixir app. Phoenix is terrible. So we had it was an opposite reaction that we were looking for. But part of the reason, and it's partly our fault, because we had this like web models directory. So like I turned into, there were some Elixir compiler issues that didn't allow us to do code reloading within the lib directory. So we changed it from, let's send this good message from isolation to, well, let's just say that anything you want code reloaded goes in web. So what happened was, this is our fault, web models was supposed to be the place you modeled your domain, but it lived inside web. So it's like it was a conflicting message, and we have changes to Elixir compiler now that allows us to move code reloading, or really we're just code reloading everything in the application. So we can now move web inside. And we still, so the goal is we wanted to send this message that this is your app and the web part is just outside of that. It should just be a window into your application. So we did this web thing to send a good message, and I think people got the opposite message of, oh, it's Phoenix is doing this special thing. So with Phoenix 1.3, you run Phoenix.u, you're gonna get an application with just a web directory inside lib. So this is gonna still for us send the message, hey, this is our web interface back into our main application. And the application domain isn't going to be in some models directory, right? Because the entire goal for your application is to model your domain. So your app just lives in normal lib code like any other Elixir app. And furthermore, we're going to add a web namespace. So slightly more typing, but since we have the alias helpers already in our router and the WebEX helpers, this is going to be, I think, a non-issue. And I think this further sends the message that we're going to have a web part of our application, and that's just a window into the rest of our Elixir infrastructure. And our generators are changing. This is kind of not huge work, but there's quite a bit of work going into this because generators have always been about learning tools, getting up and running quickly, so they're code generators. And we've always said that they're learning tools, but I think that we've done a poor job of teaching. And the reason is when you run a generator to generate like CRUD, HTML, or JSON controllers and echo schemas, we generated code like this. So we generated reasonable code, it's not terrible code. So it's like fetch all the comments from our repo, and the repo abstracts the storage. So there's some nice things that we were showing off there. And even for persistence, like if you're trying to create some comments, we would generate code like this, where you say, okay, I create a change set, so have a data structure that holds a list of changes and apply those to the database. So the echo abstractions are great abstractions, but the problem is we are not sending the proper isolation message here. Because what happened was we would be hand-waving, saying like, oh, well, if you need to do something more complex, like you can push that code into a module and define some functions. But to no fault of their own, so newcomers would see this code, and they would say, oh, Phoenix generated my code in a controller. Like, oh, this must be where my code lives. This is where they write. This is where newcomers write their code, and it's not their fault. It's our fault. As people see, oh, I do repo insertion, database changes in my controller, so this must be where I write my code. And it gets worse because if they want to do anything more complex, like if you want to start associating posts with comments, if you're building a blog system, you're going to go to that generated code, and you're going to say, oh, well, my code lives in a controller here. This means put it here. I'm going to fetch a post now. I'm going to add these two lines and build the association. And you start seeing that we're not sending the right message because you know, the vast majority of users aren't going to start thinking like, maybe I should start moving this code out into a different module, so if I want to create posts and channels, I don't have to duplicate this. What usually happens is users just duplicate this code in their channel and the rest of their application infrastructure. So for us, we're not sending the proper message, and that's awful. So we want to say, we're still to include generators. We're still to treat them as learning tools. But we're going to require that you pass some module context here. So instead of saying exchange gen, JSON comment, generating a bunch of CRUD stuff for comments, you have to pass a module namespace. In this case, it's an exchange gen JSON log comments. So I have to give this a place to live in my application. And it's going to generate a controller like this, where We have a blog, list comments, kind of like generalized functions that are doing some kind of work, or blog.create comments. And for us, this sends a better message, right? If, you know, the absolute minimum scenario is a user sees this and they're like, wow, a blog module, create comment, this is where my code lives. And then they write code there as they do an application. So this is, I think, the proper way to go for learning. It's the proper way to go about really any production level application. So users are going to see these generate functions, and list comments and create comment, these are functions that just do that same Ecto persistence. So I think, you know, Ecto is great. I think everyone should use Ecto. Phoenix will continue to ship with Ecto by default, but we're going to wrap up that data access away from the web part of your application, right? You should just call on something that's part of your domain to do the work. In this way, when users want to go to add posts and associate them with comments, instead of saying, oh, I need to build that association and those details in my controller, rather than just say, oh, I've got a function for that. Phoenix generated this get post function. So I can just call into that get post, and then I can extend that create comment with the post, right? So I think this is sending really the message of isolation, and it's just modules and functions, right? This isn't like us trying to be architecture astronauts. It's just, you know, we don't have to say, you don't have to call this an interactive pattern or command pattern. It's just, we're creating a module for you, and it has functions. Pretty much like all functional programming for me. Like when I was first getting into it, I was trying to look for like where are the functional programming design pattern books. Just thinking like, how do you design programs? And it turns out like, oh, it's all just modules and functions. And that's how you can build applications. So it's kind of an interesting way to do things that we've been doing it wrong all along the world. And one idea that works boring, if you notice on this previous slide, is we have no error case here. So we're saying, well, we're using the new width macro, we're saying we're going to match on these positive cases. And if it was all successful, then we put a status and we send a response. But let's say, like, what happens if a post is not found? Or what happens if we fail to create a comment because it was invalid? So this is just an experiment. So I'm going to open up a repo to get some feedback from the community. But the idea is, what if we just match on all the positive cases? And we let this fall through to another function that handles some error case or some other response case in our application. It wouldn't even necessarily be an error case. We might be able to return directives like, please render this. And we can then check if we have something in cache and render from cache, even though I haven't heard anyone that really has needed a complex caching solution yet. But the idea is that we have some responder callbacks where you can say, I'm going to match on all the positive cases in my controller. And then if I don't return a connection there, but if we had a callback that returned that received the original connection that was passed to the controller and whatever clause didn't match in the width expression. And this way you can say, you know, all the parts of my application are returned maybe error not found, right? If I try to catch a post or catch a stale order in my system, I'm gonna have some generalized responses in my domain like error not found, and anytime I hit that in the controller, I can just put the proper status and respond with 404. Or anytime I have an error change set, right? Or JSON controller is almost always the same type of code, just saying, okay, put the status under the change set view, error.json, pass the change set in. So wouldn't it be nice if you just say, you know what, whenever we get this result from a controller, that we'll just put that status in under the change set. And this works really nicely for JSON, because it's almost always the same repetition. But I do think we'll have to visit how this is going to work for HTML, because HTML, you're almost always going to handle the unexpected error cases, such as like, you're going to put some flash message, you're going to do some redirects. So I think for JSON, it's much more succinct. But for HTML, it will be much similar to just a case expression. And if you get error, change set, you know, rewrite the form or whatnot. And web model is gone, or any mention of model in the code base is going to be huge. Because it turns out it's just confusing for people. The message we wanted to send was, this is where you model your application domain, turned into, oh, let's just add 500 files to a root level model store. So it just became a dumping ground for files. So if you look at any application, and this is what our generators would do, they would just dump a root level user, post, comments, you're going to end up with no boundaries in your system, right? When you look at this directory, you just have 100 files, and you don't know where the boundaries are, so you're going to end up with really poor isolation. You're not going to have to think about where those boundaries should look. So for us, there's just, you know, there's no need to have a separate models thing because your entire application, your entire Elixir application's goal is to model your domain, right? So if you're going to switch from web models or any mention of models to say, have a directory structure like this, where if you have some blog that you're building, when we generate XPHGN, HTML, blog, post, you have a blog directory, and then your echo schemas, or any regular Elixir files, are living within that directory, right? Like, this isn't rocket science, it's like, this is how you would build an application in Elixir today, right? So we're just going to generate these boundaries for you to show that, okay, we have a blog system in our app, and that's how we interact with our blog system, is through our blog module, right? We're not going to be doing repo fetches on post directly. We're going to have this interface, this boundary, which is the context module. And same if we have like a sales system in the app, we have some sales module, and we might have orders and payments. If I want to complete an order, you know, there should be a function like sales.complete order, right? And this way we have a clear separation in our application, and these boundaries are going to form natural layers for you to reason about. And if you want to later split these out in a separate umbrella, you've already had to think about the boundaries. And so then your web directory turns into just the web window of your application, right? Your channels controllers and views are just going to consume the domain layer and not really know and have to worry about the details, which was the goal from the beginning. So we also want to focus on umbrella projects. And just getting to the umbrella, I'm a really bad procrastinator. So when I was putting this talk together, like, this was my accomplishment for one meeting. It was like, I'm getting so much done. Like, this is going to be so awesome. It's going to be an umbrella. So, this is one of those right here. So, for those of you that don't know, umbrella projects are a feature in Elixir that I think are kind of underserved. They allow us to basically group up a bunch of separate Elixir applications underneath one umbrella, underneath one code base. So, like, if you're into microservices or you're interested in the microservices type, this is basically microservices with all the downsides. We can run all these applications together, we can start them and stop them as a whole, we can run them separately, but they don't have to live in separate repos, they can communicate just across the same LLVM instance. So I think they're a really cool way to go out with larger platforms. Not that everyone should just be using Umbrella for everything, but I think it's a great way to go out with applications that you plan to be a substantial part of your infrastructure. But for us, we want to be able to say mixpx.newmyapp-umbrella. And the umbrella generator now will generate something like this, where there's an apps directory and we'll add two applications if you generate a Phoenix umbrella application. One will be, you know, I do mixpx.newmyapp, one will be apps.myapp. And that's going to be the place that your name domain lives. And the other is going to be, you know, myapp_web. And that's going to be where your web application lives. And this is forcing you to think about the isolation boundaries, because your web app now is just the web app, just the web server, and it's going to call in to the other application. And I forgot to mention, we also have a two-level assets folder now, so web static is going away, and in both a regular Phoenix app and an umbrella app, the assets folder now is a way for us just to encapsulate everything about your asset system. So there's no longer going to be a two-level good models directory. Everything about the app, whether it's like an Ember app, whether you're building a React app, or just using Phoenix's default ES6 JavaScript, is going to live within assets. So that's where your package.json lives, that's where everything about the asset details lives. That way it doesn't include the Elixir project. That way you can just build that separately in assets, is where you can let the asset system handle it. But for umbrella apps, it's the exact same alias. So like, admin_web, you'll still have like a my app web and page controller. So the nice thing is if you want to eventually start using umbrella apps or you want to convert your application to an umbrella app, it's going to be the same model namespace. People are already thinking with the right isolation. And I think it's a good default to consider umbrella apps because you're not, I think like in the beginning spoke, we take you from a basic app to an umbrella app, you have to convert it. And it's not a lot of work, but I think it's enough work that, you know, as developers, we're lazy. So none of us are going to be like, let me take 20 minutes to move some files around and fix some error messages. So I think it's a good idea to consider umbrellas and at least experiment with them as a good fit for your application. And this way, the changes we're making are going to make those transitions easier. If you start with a regular application, you upgraded to an umbrella, you've already thought about the boundaries in your application, you've already properly namespaced the web part of your application, and hopefully isolated that code on your domain. So that's umbrella apps. The next thing, and the big next focus for me, is service discovery. And I talked about this in Berlin at ConfEU, but I want to take a little bit of a journey back a couple years to begin with the beginning and see how this came about. So in 2014, the very first ElixirConf, I had this slide here, so it's kind of neat for me to revisit this. I had my goals for this web framework. So from the beginning, I wanted to kind of redefine what it meant to be a web framework. But I had this idea of, like, what should we call Phoenix? And I was like, oh, maybe we can call it a distributed web services framework. And I had no idea what that meant, or how that would work. But I knew that, like, okay, we had this remote machine. We could do these distributed things. Like, we had the technology, so I wanted to make distributed web services eventually. That was my eventual goal. And in 2014, you know, so this was just an ambitious goal that I really, you know, had no concrete idea of how I would accomplish it. But I knew that we could do it. So I said, okay, like, let's ship Phoenix 1.0. It's going to have main web features. You can build CRUD applications. You can build JSON applications. And then maybe after that, we can look into distributed services and service node discovery, like further ahead. You know, I said that the goal was we wanted to create Phoenix to essentially be a toolkit for easily creating distributed fault-tolerant services that scale, right? And then, like, the even further future was we wanted to centralize and master this service registration. And I even had it in eventually there because I was like, wow, I have no idea how we would solve that. That would be like years out, like 5 years out. But these were my goals in 2014. So the cool thing is, like, we accidentally accomplished most of these goals over the past year. Somehow. So a year after that, we shipped Phoenix 1.0, it was gaining some traction, we were writing web services in it, and I said my main goal was to add Phoenix Presence, which would be this presence system. And here's me, like, I already have a hand up, like, how are we gonna solve this? I don't know. But I'm going through, like, all the problems in this slide. Like, we have, like, what if a node goes down? How do we handle distributed state without a, how do we do it in a masterless way? How do we handle this distributed events happening in the system in a way that is going to scale and not have a bunch of downsides in current solutions? I didn't know how we'd do it, but I knew that we could do it, right? We had this runtime, we had the technology. So over the last year, we solved that. We solved, like, how do we show which users are online in our application? And it ended up being really trivial for the end users, which is the goal for Phoenix and Elixir. I think, you know, enabling people to build these scalable applications, but not to actually worry about the underpinnings and know how, you know, understand every distributed detail in a distributed system. Because at the end of the day, if you want to build a presence feature for your app, you add 2 lines of code to your channel. You can say, hey, presence, like my sockets, and put some metadata in so people can know about this. And you can push down on your current users that are a member of the topic that we're subscribed to. So 2 lines of code on the server, and then a few lines of code in the client. Like, you have presence sync state, presence sync div, for us to handle this replicated information across the cluster. So a few lines of code on the client server, you can end up with this system that automatically updates when users join or leave. You can detect when no downloads happen. You don't have to worry about cleaning up that data of users coming offline or members of that node. Or if you have some net split scenario in your system, like what if a net split scenario happens and then nodes come back up? Like, all of that is handled transparently, and there's just a few lines of code for you to write on the server and client. So we accomplished that, and it was amazing, and I think people, I guess, who here is using Phoenix Presence? We have any users? Awesome. Actually, more than I thought. Cool. So, like, 0 bugs and you've been reported so far, which is awesome. But it's always like Josie and I say, like, are people really using it? Like this? Because it's rock solid, so. So I want to demo this. Just because I can't give a talk without giving a demo, it's part of something that I have to do. So one thing that we built for our workshop, Phoenix workshop that we did yesterday, was a collaborative sketchpad. And I wanted to show off Phoenix Presence, but in a way that was more than just showing which users were online. So if you can see, this application has Chris and Brian on the left and right. So we're using Phoenix Presence, you know, we built that in the workshop, like, okay, you can show which users are online. You know, it was cool, it wasn't that big of a deal, but we also wanted to show, okay, like, what if we draw something? Like, you know, we want to show the real-time features. So in this case, I can, like, draw a house, and, like, every, you know, 10 times a second, we're sending, like, X, Y coordinates across, so there's, like, quite a bit of traffic that's happening here. And it's a little bit delayed because I'm going over the public internet through a proxy. but the level of messaging that's happening when I draw a stroke is kind of insane. And especially putting this as a JSON structure is even, yeah, I think people start this. Don't do it yet. Don't do it. Okay. Response in a winning form. like this exercise was that we had like this vast untapped potential, which I talked about in Berlin, where Phoenix Presence solved, like, we wanted to solve issues that are online, and we accidentally made distributed service discovery. Like, we accidentally accomplished the goal that I wanted to do, accomplish 2 years ago. I had no idea that we would accomplish. And we also did it in a way that allows us to process places. So we quickly started realizing that this was something larger. And it was nice because I had solved problems that I thought I would solve much later. And I'm not going to talk about how a CRDC works, but if you watch my Berlin talk, I go through kind of the basics. But what we realized is we have these nodes replicating which users are online, right? So they're sending, like, I've got user 2, I've got user 1, right? So we realize that, like, these users, these presences are just processes. Like, a channel on the server as a user is just a process. So we realize that if we're replicating which users are online, it's the exact same thing as just replicating which services are online, right? Instead of trying to say, Chris is online, I can say, hey, an email service is online. This process could be user sessions. So we accidentally accomplished service discovery trying to solve this simple problem of which users are here, which is kind of convenient. And but it really did make a distributed process group. So if you're familiar with Erlang's PG2 library, it's kind of like PG3, is what we've created here. So we made a distributed process group that has some nice features on top of like what PG2 would provide. So you can have callbacks when a user or a member leaves and joins the group, and you can also add metadata to members. So for example here, I can track, okay, Chris is on this chat room, and then give me all the users in room 11. But that's the exact same thing as saying, okay, instead of which users are on a chat room, you can say like which services is your web problem. Like you can do this today. Like, you can use a presence API to store metadata and say, okay, there's two processes on a cluster, here's their PID, and you can even do cool things like add metadata in that member to do client load balancing. Right? So if you want to say, show me every service in the cluster that can do web crawling, I say, okay, this PID. But it has a lower work factor than the first one, so the client can tell it and say, I'm going to call the second service because it clearly has a lower demand. And then maybe we can, so the goal is to build like an API on top of this, which we're still exploring. And maybe you have a service.list, so give me everything that can do web crawling, and then I get a list back and I can send a message and do intelligent client load balancing on top of that. And you also want to be able to say, how do we do process placing? Like, how do we say, okay, I have an API session or I have an email service, but how do we know where to actually do that work? Like, is the client always going to have it selected? And the idea is, like, we can, by default, just shard the request. So if we see that 10 services are online and do web crawling, we can just automatically shard for you and pick one. So the client can both intelligently load balance, but also automatically load balance, and you don't have to then worry about overloading these services. But we can give you both options, right? So like, let's say like you want to develop this public API, like give me a new user session. And then internally, again, we're still exploring this, but maybe we have a service module. And instead of like in server call, we can say service call. So any service on the cluster that says it can do game sessions, please spawn me a user. Or please spawn me a game session based on this user. And that could be sharding by default and just pick one. So anyone that's available, it's just gonna be load balance field. Or you can say maybe I can pass a function here to say I have a work factor in the metadata. So then I'm going to sort by this function and pick the one that is going to do this work. So you can get some really interesting things out of Phoenix Presence based on just what's there today. And that's incredibly exciting. Because the goal is to have Phoenix make most of these things trivial for you, right? You should be able to build these distributed applications. You don't have to worry about the details. Like even me personally, like one of my favorite things about abstractions is I can go into the study scary keys for 6 months and like understand that problem domain. And now I can use presence and like it still like it delights me as much as it delights like newcomers in my workshops. Like every time like it works, you're like I can't believe that this works. Like I can like kind of shed that knowledge and then just have that work done. So the other areas of interest, so my goals for really the next phase of Phoenix, other than the generators, you know, Phoenix Core will continue to be a great platform for CRUD applications, HTML applications, JSON APIs, and then the Phoenix PubSub project has been extracted from Phoenix Core. So Phoenix PubSub is really going to be the basis for this distributed toolkit. So, you know, it's not that Phoenix isn't focusing on web applications. Phoenix Core is going to continue to be a great option for web applications, want to use Phoenix PubSub, which was what Phoenix Presence was built on, as this great distributed toolkit. So service discovery is obviously our next big area of interest. Distributed process registry, we wanted to solve, like, how do we do a distributed registry, but it turns out that the OTP team is actually trying to enhance Erlang's global registration to be more highly scalable. So for us, we're watching the developments there, and ideally, we let them solve that hard problem, and global would just be a great way to do global process registration. And then another big focus is we want to look into durable PubSub to be able to catch up on missed messages. Because right now, all of our deliveries are just like, we just give you no guarantees. So if you miss a PubSub message, it's up to you to figure out, okay, well, where do I miss these messages so a client can later say, hey, I drove through a tunnel, but these are the messages I missed. There's a lot of manual code that you have to write for that. It'd be nice if we could solve this in a way that didn't require you to add like Kafka or some queue mechanism, or roll a bunch of code yourself. It'd be nice if this just worked, just like Presence, just like magic. But there's, again, I'm going to hand over here and say, like, how would we solve that exactly? Like, what areas of CS research would we have to look into? Like, I have no idea. But throughout this whole journey, every year I've said, like, hey, we have the technology, like, we can do this. Like, how are we going to do it? I'm not sure. And then a year later, it's like, hey, we've got Presence. So I'm hoping, well, we'll see now. I'm on record now. In like 2017, I'd be like, hey, I was like, durable PubSub, how are we going to do it? And then next year, hopefully, I'm going to say, we shipped durable PubSub. So we'll see what happens. yeah, we'll see what happens. But for me, I mean, the takeaway for me throughout all this is a quote that I'm going to steal from Walt Disney. And I think it really sums up Elixir. It's that, you know, if we can dream it, we can do it. And I think, you know, this is an apt quote for where we're at today. But with Elixir, like, this is what I've done, right? This is what I've done from day one, where it's like, I just want to go write a channel here, and I somehow offer a real-time connection. And I was able to figure out how to make it happen. Or I want to solve presence, and I was able to figure out how to make it happen. So I'm going to modify this quote a little bit and say, with Elixir, you can dream it. You can do it. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for some questions. Do you see your arm in the air? Then we have one.
I'm still fairly new to Elixir, and I played with opening connections and starting processes, and I pretty quickly ran into like the max number of file descriptors per response and stuff like that. So just as a general ballpark, if you're going to spin up like 2 million connections, how do you handle the file descriptor stuff? Do you just like set a really large max value, or are there like pools of things?
You find Gaisler, Gary, Green, where's he at? And he's the one that is helping with all Phoenix channel benchmarks. Gary, are you here? Anyway, you find that guy.
Okay.
No, actually, there's just a shell file that I stole from him. So really, as Gary can attest over shared Skype sessions, like my sysadmin skills are like, they're passable, but they're hilarious. So I'm gonna try to think. I'll pull it up. So I have a shell file that I can share. It just sets like a dozen max settings on any Linux system, and that was enough for us to get to 2 million users. So it was actually a lot easier to configure the system to get there than I thought. Just the defaults are lower than they should be. I mean, 3.16, but it's not hard to tweak.
Cool. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Done.
Can you talk about some IoT sort of, when you said durable PubSub, I was sort of thinking a lot about IoT applications. Can you talk about any of them in production?
So I'm not aware of anything specifically. I mean, I know people that are doing some neat experiments. I think Justin would probably have a better handle on that and listen to his talk. But yeah, I think what's exciting for me is people are doing, Phoenix PubSub is also something that can be used totally outside of Phoenix, a web context. And Justin and I had a lot of conversations about getting some PubSub and NERVs and like the possibilities there. NERVs devices, IoT is all about these distributed systems. So it would be nice to have to be able to message each other. You know, you have things deployed in the field, but then you have to solve these problems of how do you get caught up, especially with, you know, IoT, you have to the loss of messages is more accurate, right? You have these devices and look them to these places. So I'm interested in that today, but as far as what's deployed, I'm not sure.
Anyone else?
Anyone out here?
Okay. So please help me by standing up if you want to mic. So I'm actually working on an MQTT implementation over AWS IoT and integrating it into a Phoenix application. But I guess I'm curious if anyone is working on MQTT directly in the channels or if there's any one side project like that.
Yeah, there's a Vern MQTT PubSub adapter, which I don't have any experience with, but I know people are in that space. So there's a, I think, Vern MQTT on X, and check that out. So MQTT has some interesting ideas. We looked into that when we were developing the channel protocol. So I think there's definitely an integration story there, but you'll have to find out how people are doing it.
So what you've described looks, or Phoenix 1.3 looks really great. Can you describe the roadmap from here to actually releasing it?
The roadmap, as far as like timelines?
Yeah.
When it's ready. it shouldn't be that much work. So the nice thing is, like, it's just kind of file structure changes. So like as far as the breaking changes, you have to continue really to work. It's just going to be a matter of the default file structure. So the migration story will just be a matter of like run these commands, move these files, copy these files here. The roadmap should be soon. It shouldn't be that long. I'm trying to think. I mean, definitely by the end of the year we should have it out. We need to take care to part of that. I'm hesitant is the code work is not that much, but the Phoenix guides need to be totally overhauled to accommodate the new structure. So there's a lot of work on the guide side. There's a lot of work on having a new edition of the book out. But as far as the code changes you will have to make, if all you do is change your big steps to Phoenix 1.3, it should all continue to work. So hopefully by the end of the year we have you know, all that at least set up and people can use it, but I can't promise anything.
So I work at a company that uses Docker for deployment. Okay. Have you thought about for the distributed service discovery how that work out?
Yeah, so I admittedly have no experience with Docker, and I feel like there's some, like, I feel like it's at odds a little bit with like Erlang and Lister releases and the hack code upgrades. I feel like a lot of people will end up with having issues with Docker. And I have no experience. People will come in IRC or Slack and say, I'm trying to load up with Docker, and it sounds like they're like deleting all over the place. And unless it's like, I think it's a great choice. Sorry, let me back up. Docker seems like a great choice if that's how your existing operations are done. I think it has a lot of positive benefits. So if that's how your existing team, they just want a container and they can deploy it, and by all means deploy Elixir and Phoenix using Docker. But if like you're starting your infrastructure from scratch, I feel like Docker might be at odds with the way we do things a year or two from now, as far as the standard Elixir community. So I can't really speak to that. Sorry.
You should just open the guides in a shared session on your computer right now, and then everyone will just update them like they did with your app.
Okay, that's a good idea. I had to sketch it in handwriting though. What I tried to do originally, instead of the ASCII art, it was going to do OCR. I had it working for the workshop, but like it was like a 1% success rate. high, 12 times, and like 100 times it detected, so yeah, that'd be cool.
But for the 1.3 changes, if you were to start to restructure your applications in those directories right now, is 1.2 going to fight with that, or is it just...
Yeah, I mean, so the only thing, the only part of that is you might have to set your controller, there's an optional namespace argument to the controller for it to know which view to render. So there might be like one line of code that you have to change to start using those commitments today. But it's, Phoenix doesn't really impose really any specific structure on it.
Great, thanks.
We got a couple of minutes if we have time.
With Keynote 1.3 pushing the pushing data marshaling back down out of controllers and into more into your domain, where do you see concerns like authorization?
Yeah. So authorization for me would just be in a module that I can say like, well, what I do in my question labs, and granted authorization and like policies are a huge part of your application, but for me, I often would just have a module that says like, I pattern match on the action, the arbitrary action user is trying to hit. And if, so if I pass in like a, you know, an authorizer, I can say, if authorizer dot can't access, and I can pass in the action you're trying to do, user struct and a post. And I just have a bunch of models, well, I have a model with a bunch of functions that pattern match on like, okay, I have someone trying to create their user, and they're trying to create this post. And then I just have a function that says, okay, I'll be the owner. So for me, it's just, for my applications, it turns into just module pattern match functions. But granted, if you need something more advanced, I think there are a couple packages on text that add new things, but I've never needed much beyond that. But the nice thing about that is that can live really anywhere in your application. If you just keep it, you know, as simple as possible.
Stay tuned over the course of these 2 days to support more and to disable authorization. So that's a little bit of a teaser. Anyone else? Right, so you have it.
So lots of cool new things, especially with presence. Have you given any thought to just the ability to have these things be like their own components that can be used anywhere, not only with Phoenix, but you know, anything else that I want to be able to utilize it, like individual components?
So yeah, so we're based on plugs, so really anything that is plug compatible, you can just like, so if I wanted to plug an entirely separate Phoenix application, I could have control with that. So, do a sketch right here. Yeah. So if I had this router somewhere in the wrong project. Yeah, so since we're plug compatible, for me, I think the only story that we don't have for components is if you want to package some assets in that component, there's no good story right now other than you need to either pre-compile that and check that into your code and then plug your own plug static, or have a task that copies the static assets from your dependency into the parent application. But for us, if you have some separate, probably separate Phoenix application, let's say in this sketchpad that we built, let's say if I want to do a log system and someone has released that on X, I should just be able to say I'm going to forward anything that I'm going to mount this application. So forward is saying anything that starts with /blog is going to be forwarded to a plug of, you know, like someone else's app. Blog. And that can be a plug that can do anything. So for me, like, we already have a component story, and it's just things that apply by the plug contract. But the caveat that assets really, there's no great story there, and since we're trying to be agnostic to the asset builder, I'm not sure if we can make that better, but you check out plugs, I think it has only 95% of what we need for a component style system. We got one.
Is there any chance of extracting out part of plug that does like the hulking and the plug builder part? Because I have RPC stuff that looks a lot like my controllers, and I've had to re-implement the hulking part and the assigns part, and I haven't re-implemented plug builder because that's a lot, it's a very complicated macro, but I really like that. It would be nice if it was in some sort of like modem library that stuff has halted and your functions won't be called if you're halted the way plug is, but I don't want all the stuff with HTTP.
Yeah, so
response stuff.
You want to be able to say, you want to be able to declaratively have these list of steps, and if some condition happens, like stop the process. So I would say the answer to that, and you really check me in, like we have that now with the with macro, like with does that for us. So like plug itself can be implemented with, right? So you would say, I have some functions, so I can say, actually, I have an editor up here. Right, so the plugin itself can be totally today, you can say, I'm not gonna use the plugin anymore. I'm gonna have one function that says, like, you know, def, handle, or request. It takes some initial connection struct. And you can say, you know, with, and this might be repetitive, but I can say with con get connection, halted is false, you know, off user connection. So if that was successful, then I'm going to continue with, you know, parse JSON. And that was halted, so basically with gives us that, and whether or not that's kind of the pretty DSL you're going for, I'm not sure, but I think we have mechanisms to kind of do this procedural step, matching on happy case, and if something doesn't match, then it falls through just like plugins today. Does that help?
Yeah.
And whether that can be extracted to master is it. It says no. You want to
All right, I think we have time for the final question. Anyone?
Got one. No.
Please come up so I can see. Thank you. And keep standing so I can still see.
So, Chris, I took a look at the Phoenix presence that you guys do. It's awesome. But I was worried about the node configuration. Right now, you have to configure, you should know that it's going to be part of the presence up front, right?
No, so it's any node can come go anytime. So there's no static node list. I mean, other than you have to, it's your job to actually connect them to a distributor or. So they have to join the cluster. We're not doing that for you, but Erlang has mechanisms for you to do that. So as long as they can join the cluster, Phoenix Presence can pick up the node. It doesn't have to have a fixed set of nodes that can be part of the presence. That makes sense? Yeah, so we handle that with CRT. A node's going to come up online, and it's going to basically, when it comes up, they're going to go into sample the cluster vector blocks to see, like, you know, what kind of data do I need to get caught up on, and it's going to ask the number of nodes to, like, send all of their data to it. So there's some replication that's going on that.
Last question, anyone? Okay, I think we'll break there for...
I have Phoenix stickers, so find me if you want stickers.
Right. Well, thank you very much.